talking, hanging out, spending some time with Shaquille O'Neal. All right, Shaq, you got a lot of roles in your career. The newest one being Carnival's chief fun officer. What does that mean? What does that entail?
I'm the one that ensures that when you go on these cruises, you have fun. I used to live in Miami, across from the port of Miami, and, you know, Mick Harrison is the CEO.
Beautiful house. I used to take a couple fishing trips and take my friends around and be like, Shaq, live over there.
I was a hypocrite about the cruise ships, because I just used to see this big shape, and I figured it was for old people such as yourself. Two to one. So, you know, I figured it was for old people, and one day I had a meeting with Mickey, and I couldn't believe all the stuff that was on
the business.
Yeah, no, forget the business. They got water parks. They got restaurants. It was a beautiful thing, and I was like, Mickey. A lot of people my age, because I'm still a young guy, they don't know about this. Please let me do something with you. And he named me CFO, and I just make sure that, you know, people when they come on the boat, they just choose fun.
So what are the, are there any ship in particular you're telling us about? Anything else we need to know?
Well, yeah, I have a restaurant in Vegas called Big Chicken, and in a spring 2020, we'll be putting my restaurant on 20 ships. That's Radiance and Mardi Gras. In spring 2020.
Of course, yeah, Nick is going to have a bite. So of course. Don't worry.
There's the Shaq Daddy. There's the MD. And I even got the Charles Barkley sandwich.
Oh, there's some ham on this. This is delicious. Yes.
I don't want you to eat that. I don't want you to mess up that beautiful figure.
Thank you so much. I fully respect that.
These right here are the delicious
commercial break. I'll go for it.
From me, my mama, my grandmama, and it's doing very well.
I like it.
Is it good, Nick?
Well, it's delicious.
Yeah, I can't eat. I'm going to get some a little bit later.
Just take one little bite.
Go for it, see.
Just take a bite.
That's all.
Go for it. And go.
It's delicious. This is great. It's the first time I've eaten on the show.
Very good.
Thank you.
All right. While you guys...
You've been here since 6:30 in the
morning. Shaq, it's time for a segment we call Say What? Yesterday at the Raptors Championship Parade, all eyes were on Kawhi. He was hanging with Drake, Kyle Lowry, smoking some cigars, also had a few words to say. Say what?
Enjoy this moment and have fun with it. Aha, ha, ha, ha.
Yeah!
That's great.
That is the best parade moment since one Shaq Diesel was on stage with someone who dances just like Jenna Wolfe.
What?
What? Well, you'll see, Jenna. Oh, I thought you were going to have the Miami one. Man, I was at the Miami. Yeah, I was on the court for Miami.
You were there.
No, but I'm talking about... There you are, Jenna. Oh, yeah. There you are.
That is a very familiar move, Shaq. I've perfected that move, whatever that was.
Was he mocking the laugh that went viral?
Yes.
That was the mock.
He was making fun of himself.
Got it. That was awesome.
That was very good. That was very good.
Your boy Mark Manson danced just like Nick.
No.
Nick trying to throw it off on Jenna.
No, actually, no.
All the soul he got, bruh, is in the family. You met the wife. You met the daughter. Dude ain't got no type of rhythm.
Okay, but hold on. You have to have flavor to attract flavor.
Oh, appreciate you.
Appreciate you, Shaq. Yeah, bruh, what the hell? You my guy, man.
I learned that from your brother.
I don't need you to be boosting this dude up.
Appreciate that. I'm going to take another bite of the sandwich while we talk about the Rockets.
But check me out. I did the, when we were casting for the show, and I interviewed with him, I had saw the pictures and everything and knew on principle that I could work with him.
Right.
When we aired it, I was like, no, he's not good enough for TV, but he got some stuff about him.
Can you believe
and I saw the family unit, bro. I saw what you saw, bro.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about the Rockets.
Let's do that, shall we?
An article came out yesterday.
Here we go, Shaq.
I got food in my
mouth. That article detailed some friction between James Harden and Chris Paul.
No, that chicken is fire.
Mm-hmm. Among the conflict between the two about how to play down the stretch of playoff losses to Golden State. Shaq, how can these two resolve this? How are they able to move past this, be successful?
Friction is good sometimes, but it's one word that you must have when you have friction. It's respect. Everyone knows about the Kobe Shaq story. We had a lot of friction, but we had respect. We had so much respect that after the first championship, when I put my hands up, who jumps in my arm? Kobe Bryant.
Kobe.
So it's okay to have friction. All that be nice and hold hands and win championship, I don't know if that's what it's about all the time.
That's overrated.
I think it's overrated because I hear a lot of horror stories. The Bulls had horror stories. Magic had horror stories. The Rockets had horror stories. But I know that you have to respect the person. I do think personally that James holds the ball a little too much because, again, it ain't about what you're doing. It's about what the others are doing. And if the others ain't in a rhythm, they can't help you win. No one guy can do it. Michael couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. Kobe couldn't do it after I left. D-Wade couldn't do it before I got there. It, you know, you have to, you know, work as a team. And when they got off the ball and Tucker was hitting shots and everybody was hitting shots, they looked unstoppable. That's why they were the favorite to beat the Warriors. But then, you know, something happened where just, you know, one guy keep taking all the shots and you're not going to win like that.
But for Chris Paul, how hard is it for an all-time great, of which he is, when you are at a different phase of your career? When you're no longer league MVP candidate, you're still a good, quality, productive player, but you're no longer the guy you
were. And this is totally different than you, bro, because you went to a lot of places at the end of your career, but everyone loves Shaq. That's why they made you CFO. Everyone loves Shaq. Is Shaq fit in this locker room? Where? Cleveland. Yes. Will Shaq fit in this locker room? Yes. Chris Paul
is a little more
and yourself has a different reputation.
Yeah, but he still has the ability to get the ball and get others involved. That's what a point guard is supposed to do. You know, a lot of teams, ever since Golden State entered the scene, a lot of teams have switched it up to just a, you know, a guard orientated. Like, I haven't seen a guy post up at all. You know, you see a lot of guards posting up, but, you know, when we were playing, it was all about the big guys posting up. So the game is definitely different, but I think they could, you know, coexist. They just got to, you know, get off the ball.
How impressive what you saw in this playoff run. I always watch your coverage. Your show is one of the best shows. I've been on some pregame shows, but that show that you do is the best pregame show. I watch it religiously. What did you think about what Kawhi Leonard was able to accomplish in this postseason?
Listen, he plays the right way. I like his game that when he doesn't get a call, go his way, he never makes a face. He never complains. He just plays. And, you know, he's not a guy that's very flamboyant. He's not going to do a lot of things. He got an old school, new school game. Like, it was just one, two dribbles. Not really fast. Just one, two dribbles, get to a spot and play. And he's probably top three. Like, I don't like to say who's the best player, but, you know, well, LeBron's still the best player in the league, but, you know, KD's a very close second.
Mm-hmm. And I don't like to say who's the best player. These are your top three. No, maybe I do like to say.
No, I don't want to make a list, Shaq, LeBron is the best.
Where do you want to see Kawhi end up next season, and where do you think he inevitably will end up next season?
He's the king of Toronto. He's the emperor of Canada. I wouldn't leave.
You'd stay.
Oh yeah.
Do you think he'll stay though?
I don't know him. I've never. You know, he really doesn't talk much, so we can't speculate what he's gonna do. But you asked the question. If I was him and I'm the king in a different country, I will stay there. Shaquillicus O'Neilicus would stay.
You said when we were talking Lakers, a couple opportunities. When we talked about best duo, when we talked about favorite. You said best duo is still the guys in Golden State. Favorite, still Golden State. I think most people would have thought that 2 weeks ago. But since Kevin Durant ruptured his Achilles and Klay Thompson tore his ACL, they're in more disarray than we've seen them in 5 years. First one, do you think Kevin Durant re-signs with Golden State?
I don't know. You know, you hear a lot of, listen, I watch all the sports shows. I watch this show. Everybody has an opinion or thought. I don't know.
If he asked your advice, what would you give him?
He's not going to ask my advice. He doesn't need my advice. He's already a great player, has multiple championships. He knows what he needs to do to run and control his brand. But if you want to keep winning, like, listen, it's two things. You want to win or you want to get paid. That's what this game is all about. So if you want to continue winning, you got to stay. You want to get paid and you want to, you know, run your own team and you want to, you know, be the man, you come to the Knicks, right? So. Mm-hmm. I don't know what he's going to do, but I know that he's definitely going to come back with vengeance.
Not from an advice standpoint, but there have been very few players like you on and off the court. I remember reading a story about you as a youngster, I think 14 or 15, and your foot size at that time, you couldn't find shoes for yourself. Someone went out of their way to be able to get some shoes to you. And since then, I know that you go down to Freeman's and you've done a lot of different things, but there's a lot of young athletes that you've kind of adopted. And here recently, I saw that you were out with the kid, helping him buy shoes to be able so he could play on the basketball court. But I know your mom's had a great influence, your dad's had a great influence. But what makes a person keep giving after the way you've been given to society for such a long time?
I came after I retired and I gave my mother a very flamboyant gift. She said, take it back. I said, this is for you. I love you. She said, I know, but you need to start doing stuff to brighten other people's day. That's what I want to see people say about you when I hear stuff now. So once a day, once a week, I just try to pick something out and just try to, you know, make a person smile. So it came across my line that a lady and her 18-year-old son couldn't afford shoes. I went back. That was me. And we called Bruce. You know, my father called Bruce because we went to the Spurs. My father talked to Popovich. Mm-hmm. Popovich said, yeah, that Bruce. So we called Bruce on the line. I was going to prom. I was trying to get some burgundy penny loafers because I had a nice burgundy suit with a cold blazer. I was about to kill him. So anyway, we called Bruce, and Bruce said, yeah, Sarge, I'll see you. The penny loafers, price is $189. My dad was like, we don't have $189. Can we do a layaway? And Bruce said, nope, your son's going to be a fabulous guy. Get him. Just make sure when he goes pro, he comes back. So I live in Atlanta, and Bruce was the one that gave me a free pair. So when I saw the kid and I saw his mom, it reminded me of me and my mother. So I just bought him 10 pair.
That's awesome.
Real quick, only like 30 seconds here before we go. A couple days ago was Father's Day. How's your son doing? Big time prospect.
My son is doing fabulous. He's playing great. It was very tough what we were going through. I just try to walk him through as best as I can. Funny story. So you know he's a tough kid. He was really hard up, and then when he got to the table, he started to get scared because we're about to get surgery. So I told him, I said, listen, I know you're scared, but it's a beautiful nurse about to come in. Her name is Anesthesia.
You're going to feel better.
Speaking of Father's Day, can I bring my niece out here to tell you happy Father's Day?
Of course, and let us do this.
Absolutely. Yes. And Shaq, while we're doing that,
baby girl,
tell us again which carnival ships we can find your chicken sandwiches on next
Radiance
year.
And Mardi Gras.
Good stuff.
Radiance and Mardi Gras. Oh, your niece? I thought your niece was actually
here. You've
been adopted. Uncle Chris to Uncle Shaq. This is how we do it. You've been upgraded.
I want you to
make sure you get the name right in the wheel.
Do me a favor.
Yeah.
Do me a favor. Hug your daddy and say, I love you, Daddy. Happy Father's Day.
I love you, Daddy. Happy Father's Day.
And now do me a favor. Tell Shaq who the greatest basketball player of all time is.
LeBron.
There you go.
Good job.